Which did you like better, Jedi or The Empire Strikes Back?
Empire.
Blasphemy.
All Jedi had was a bunch of Muppets.
Boring conversation anyway.
Hey, Star Wars fans, and welcome to Boring Conversation Anyway. This is episode 130, and I'm one of your hosts, Chris, and as always, I'm joined by my other host, Thor. How you doing, buddy?
I'm good. I just came to the realization that, like, my great-grandkid someday would be like, hey, there's 130 hours of my great-grandfather talking about Star Wars. You want to listen to that someday?
And also, God, is he really upset about everything?
Doesn't seem like a cheerful guy.
He's so mad. Oh, we're here to talk about the Book of Boba Fett today.
Book of Boba Fett.
Yeah.
We just watched it together in the same place, which is, like, very rare. We've been friends for a long time, but I moved away as soon as new Star Wars content started being made. So we've never actually, like, watched something new together. And it's fun.
And anything we've watched new together has been seen by us separately and then watched again together. Like,
yeah, usually.
Solo, I believe at that point, Force Awakens when you came back in for Christmas. This is the first time we were side by side on the couch watching it for the first time. Everything is new and fresh.
Neither of us had seen it before.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So again, this is the Book of Boba Fett, Chapter 1, which is, that was out there forever, that this was going to be Chapter 17, a continuation of The Mandalorian. So that's put to rest now.
But it's out there from who?
It's a great question. Yeah. Well, you know, if someone picks it up, it runs with it, it goes everywhere. I mean, this was being deemed Mandalorian Season 2.5, is what they were calling it. Mm-hmm. So, again, by who, though? Who comes up with this stuff, right? But we got our Chapter 1, Stranger in a Strange Land.
Right.
So, before we dive into this whole thing, give me your non-spoiler review of the show.
Non-spoilers is that I liked it. It felt like The Mandalorian, meaning in a good way. Just, like, I feel the same way I feel kind of coming off Mandalorian episodes. Like we were saying, underwhelming compared to the other two first episodes.
Right.
Meaning the two... the first episode of the first season of Mandalorian, first episode of the second season of Mandalorian. I rank it third. But that being said, not bad at all. Doesn't mean anything. But yeah, so good, and I'm eager. I have a lot of questions, and we'll get into all that stuff.
Yes.
But, you know, it's pretty much what I had expected. I think this is a non-spoiler that we haven't got into. There's a lot of action and a lot of great action. I'm not somebody who necessarily is always like, Give me, you know, more and more violence or that. I don't necessarily go into that sort of thing. But that being said, I thought if you want to call the violence, the action was a little underwhelming as well.
Okay. All right.
And we'll get into that more.
So I agree with you a lot of this. I would say, like I was telling you, that I would say we have one other live action show to compare this to. If we're just sticking with the live action, we have The Mandalorian.
Right.
And I would say both of those seasons, episodes, the first episodes, were better than this episode. Also, because we've had two seasons of The Mandalorian, we don't have the wow factor anymore of the technology that they're using to put this together. We're used to it now. And now we want it to be better and better and better. So we don't get that. So now we're grading it for what it is. And as for what it was for a first episode, it was a little underwhelming. I wouldn't put it lower than a B, I don't think, because, you know, I'm not a harsh critic of Star Wars, but to me, it wasn't, you know, the greatest thing I've seen.
You know what I think is a good sign of it being, like, underwhelming? And again, don't take that word too literally. It's just, you know, because it is very good. But your kid came down and he had already seen it. And I was like, you know, kind of jokingly tell him to go away until it was over. And he's like, isn't it, like, almost over? And he was right. So, like, the feeling of, like, oh, it just ended.
Right.
I was, that's, like you said, it's good that I want to see more. But at the same time, I feel like this really could have benefited from, and I don't think this is the case, one of those, we're debuting it on, you know, on Wednesday, and then it airs every Friday.
Right, yes.
That's not the case. We have to wait a full week, right?
They could have did more of, hey, we're going to, yes, you're right.
That's what they did with the Mandalorian.
Right, if we're going to know what they should have did, is because we know Wednesday is the normal day, they should say we're going to air the first one on Monday, give you the second one on Wednesday, boom. Yeah, I get what you're saying. It's, yeah. But, all right, it is what it is. And again, there's a lot of stuff in here to like, and we're going to break it all down. And I'm not saying I didn't like it. I'm just saying it's a little different.
Lots to talk about.
I thought the action was a little hokey, a little weird to me.
Yeah.
That shot of, now, you know, spoilers, by the way. That's it. We're not warning anymore.
Right. Spoilers, everybody.
The shot when he takes one of those stun wands away from the assassins and comes down. And he's got that face on. I was like, all right.
Well, here's the thing. Here's we're going to jump around. But since you brought it up and we're talking about the action, I made this reference. We never learned really who those guys were, what they wanted.
We're assuming we know who they are. We're assuming they're from the mayor. That's me.
Okay, I'm assuming, but we never definitively learned who they are, because they could have easily been from the person whom he had just visited.
We have a lot to talk about.
And
that
they're like,
too.
Hey, we gave him his tribute, but like, we want it back. However, they have these, you know, we see a lot of this stuff in Disney era Star Wars, these, you know, sticks that have electricity, with
vibro axes,
you see the shields and stuff. And don't get me wrong, like, shields aren't anything new, but it's just, I compared it to, like, you know, if you look at Boba Fett, that's what I said to you. If you look at Boba Fett and you see him as like a mob boss or something, right? Well, imagine going and attacking like John Gotti at the top of his game. But you're doing it with paintball guns and like pepper spray.
Yeah, why were they bringing the guns?
Like,
yeah,
he was fool had his helmet on for like 1 minute, and that was when he was in the Sarlacc pit. You could have shot him in the head.
All right,
this guy's walking around Tatooine like
you're getting.
I want everyone to see me walking like a man with my helmet off. You know, because
there was a lot of Marvel.
One's ever been assassinated with a shot to the head before.
I call it a lot of Marvel because this guy had his helmet on for about 40 seconds.
And listen. I've always critiqued, like, that was always going to be my thing, was like, all right, if you're going to give me a Boba Fett show, it should be the Boba Fett that I remember, which is him with a helmet on.
Yep.
And, okay, it's an actor, whatever, we're going to see him in a lot of different scenarios, but if you're going to have the helmet on at any point, walking around town might be a good time for it. Fighting somebody might be another good time for it.
It's a little confusing. Listen, I understand your point about it being an actor, but I'm not knocking him. But it's not like it's Robert Downey Jr. in the suit. All right? I don't think you have to have the helmet off.
Nobody's like, hey, how do you say his name again? I can't remember.
Tamara Morrison? Yeah. We need to see him.
Like, everybody loved him in Aquaman.
Hey, the dogs are with us. It is what it is. We're rocking and rolling.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That's it. It won't be as bad as Kevin Smith podcast.
Yeah, it won't be coughing up alone.
Oh, well, maybe. So anyways, let's go back to the beginning. Back to the beginning.
Let's start there.
Back to Tank.
Well, before we even get there, because I got some stuff to talk about that, we get a nice shot of the palace.
Sure.
Right?
Yeah.
The good angle is the angle, I believe, with the creature that eats the frog creature that's out there, if you remember that shot from Jedi. But inside, we get the empty hallways, which I believe was a matte painting, which looked really cool. So I wonder if it's an actual one from Ralph that they just grabbed and used, but it looked really cool. We see it's all quiet. We get upstairs. Beautiful upstairs, huh? Did he think he had time to redo that? Or do you think that's the way Jabba was living upstairs? Like, downstairs was all gross, and upstairs looked like, you know, all home improvement stuff.
I don't know.
Right?
You never really wondered even, like, what what the rest of it looked like.
I didn't know there was a rest as a kid, I thought. Until I started playing the video games where you could run around the thing.
You assumed it was...
I assumed he was living downstairs with the rest of everybody else.
That's because, like, when you were kids, you see him, like, wake up with, like, all of his... Like as a child, I just assumed that him and his entire court had huge slumber parties in the palace. Like, every night, they all sleep there. Like, no blankets, no pillows, no cushions.
Just pass out.
Jabba's comfortable sleeping in the same position he exists in.
And because we're kids, we're not thinking it's because they're drinking their heads off.
We
just think they're hanging out.
Yeah, they're just lying to sleep.
I mean, they got all together in that one hallway so they could surprise Han and Leia.
That being said, like, you know... That Bacta tank probably came from somewhere else.
Right.
Because it's not a Jabba size. No, and, like, you're moving into a Hutt's house, like, you're not going to right away be able to, like, move into his master bedroom.
Right.
Like, none of that's made for you.
Yes.
Like, I can't imagine Jabba uses the same toilet that Boba Fett would use. I mean, Boba Fett might be able to use Jabba's toilet, but not the other way around. There's no way. What would Jabba do if he slithered up to a urinal?
I have no idea, man.
How do slugs even?
I don't know.
Well, we're getting off topic.
That's a great question.
Let's reel it back in.
So he's in the back to tank, and we already see the scars are gone, and he has eyebrows. So he's been doing this for a while. And now we can see that the back to tank is a device to give us the past, to fill in some of the blanks. And boy, did it, huh? It starts off right away where you see Kamino in the rain. And then it leaves that and goes to...
Big deal.
I know, it's always raining.
It's always raining. Show me Kamino when it's sunny out.
Wow!
Also, they didn't even, like, show anything.
No, they just went to it and then left. It was like a little...
Yeah.
Like, it was a weird dream.
And then they,
He was holding his father's helmet, Jango Fett's helmet.
Right, which that looked like straight from the movie, right?
Yeah, they just took that, I would say.
So those, like, flashbacks was kind of cool. Like, I complimented the show on this right away, which was, like... It seemed like they're getting and this is why I kind of forgive it for being underwhelming.
Right.
They seem to have just, like, listen, we're going to get all those questions you have about, like, how we got from Return of the Jedi to where you see him in The Mandalorian. We're going to answer a lot of those.
Right,
right. Right off the bat. So, like, here's how we got out. Here's what happened. And there's still more to be said because we haven't discovered. Well, we've seen him get the respect of the sand people that captured him, but we haven't gone further than that. Maybe we won't. Maybe that's the end of it.
Because the biggest mystery here is time. Yeah. What's the time? That's what we know. That to the second season of The Mandalorian, we're past 5 years. 5 years was the first season. And if you go by, just rewatch it to get ready for this. If you go by episode 4 of season 2, so it's when he goes back to Nevarro to see Cara Dune again and stuff.
Right.
She's already the sheriff there. And you could tell time, he said, I heard that you could tell time has gone by. So... Who knows? It could be 6-7 years at that point when Boba Fett enters into Mandalorian season 2.
Yeah.
We're not sure. So we have at least 5 years to fill in.
Yeah.
And we got to start there. So we get to Kamino, and then after that, right inside the pit.
Isn't disappointing. Right? Like, they didn't do anything terribly... it looked about the way I would kind of imagined it to have gone.
Right, exactly.
They did add a little bit to it. I think it went really well. Like... It looked the way I thought it would, being trapped in a Sarlacc.
Yep.
You made a... And that was another thing. How long has he been in that Sarlacc pit? We were trying to figure out. There's really no indication because... No. We saw the ruins of the sand barge, but you and I were talking about it. We're like, well, there's no sand on it, but it could have been uncovered by wind.
Right.
And
but also, I feel like he woke up. Like, he got knocked out when he got into the pit. I feel like it's the same day, if not the next day.
See, and it's hard to tell because you made a comment of, like, why is there a stormtrooper? And I said, well, the stormtrooper got thrown in there before all the events in Jedi, obviously.
Would have to.
And he looked pristine. So that's why...
His armor was white. But if you looked at the armor, whereas Boba had the paint loss, his had holes.
So you think... The acid and stuff, the things that have caused Boba Fett's disfiguration, couldn't break down the armor, just like it couldn't break down his armor, but over time, it broke down what was inside.
If you go look at that again, what I'm trying to say, it broke down the Stormtrooper armor.
Yeah, but not that badly.
No, there was holes in the helmet, there was holes in the chest, there was holes in the arm, so I think it killed the guy, and that's why he went there and he grabbed the breathing tube from them because it filters out the gases and everything, right? Because we learned about that. Yeah. And he started using it. The guy didn't fight back. The guy was already dead. You know what I mean? So
I think I get the impression that under 24 hours.
For Boba.
For Boba Fett.
You could tell me that what's his name. I'm just making an assumption.
Yeah.
When the droids landed on Tatooine, they were combing that planet to find the droids.
Mm-hmm.
It could have been a garrison of troops were in that direction, and one guy just fell in. Could have been something like that.
It could have been.
You know what I mean? It's only been a couple years. If it takes 1,000 years to digest the thing in your body, it's a slow process, right?
Yeah, but I like the idea better of Jabba putting him in there because, like, ooh, what happened to the stormtrooper? It's like, oh, yeah, he just stumbled in. That's not terribly interesting. So I was thinking, like, you know, you're Jabba the Hutt. You might have a little bit of frictions with the Empire, but you don't want to bring the entire Empire on you, even though you're a big crime lord. So you got to make a stormtrooper you have an issue with completely disappear. Throw him in the Sarlacc pit.
That's true, too. It's true.
But anyways, there's a million ways to get rid of a stormtrooper. But
we learned how he escaped.
Which is cool, and I brought that up. I really liked that he didn't come out through the mouth of the Sarlacc. I like that he came out through the sand and found really his cool. own way. And there was enough of it that made it interesting, but it was also kind of the same, which was also good. Like, it was a really a perfect blend. So I think I was saying how, like, if you're going to do this, you've got to make it interesting. If you're going to show that, you've got to make it interesting
right.
or different. And I think they did just enough of that.
I do, too. It's it wasn't like different. He had a big battle with it. He just flamed him from the inside to make it weak or whatever, to go through with the tissue, and he came out through the sand. Kind of reminded me a little bit of Kill Bill. I don't know if you watched those movies or not, but she gets buried and she has kind of remember that a little bit. I thought it was cool. And then he's passed out basically by the mouth of it, and that night he just gets robbed by Jawas. That was a little one that was like, oh, okay, it's, you know, I thought maybe he lost it over time with the sand people, but no, it's straight up. We knew we got to the Jawas, but he got to the Jawas quick.
I always figured it did. I always figured that either the Sarlacc had spit up the armor for some reason it got off of him, you needed to get out of
right.
it. Right. Or what happened.
So now the question, let's just stick with this line before we keep going into what happens next. That Jawa Sandcrawler right. had Boba Fett's armor on it for 5 years. So either they never wanted to put it out when they were showing droids and stuff like that because they didn't think they wouldn't get what they wanted for it, or they nearly never really wanted to sell it until Cad Bane comes around with the Cantano of some kind of crystals.
Yeah, I like to think that it was just a matter of not finding a customer for it. So, like, the Jawas, because the Jawas are greedy.
Right.
So you would kind of figure, like, why would you hang on to this? You would turn it into something. You can't use it.
Right.
So why wouldn't you turn it into...
But also Jawas... But
they're greedy, so they might be like, we know it's worth, and we're not...
We're not giving it up until we get what
it
is.
That makes sense to me.
Yeah, right.
So Fennec Shand awakens him from his sleep in the...
Not yet.
What else happens?
Gets the sand people pick him up.
All in that first one?
Yeah. It dives down when he has the battle with the sand person with the stick versus the giant stick. That's when she wakes him up.
Right. So, yeah,
So the narrative is now the Jawas leave him alone, and he gets cooked by the sun. So we're trying to determine whether or not that was all sunburn or if it was the acid.
It's acid because he was face down.
And he still had it on his face, right? We determined
the sun could have reflected, depending on how long he was there. But
yeah. He's in bad shape no matter what. And he gets picked up by some sand people.
Right.
Different type of sand people that we're used to. They're not wearing all the same colors. There are a lot of dark colors, black colors.
Yeah.
Gets them back to their camp. There's, like, the chieftain is there, which is pretty cool looking. That was a really cool looking sand person, if you ask me.
Yeah. Yeah. Go ahead and pre-order your black suit. hey, sand people don't really seem like the type to care about what they're wearing. Like, yeah, but we got to sell action figures.
Yeah, so. Yeah. I did like that. I mean,
they're cool looking.
They're tribes, and I like that there's different tribes. Yeah.
Like we've talked about before, like, they've done more for the
Mandalorian, and this show has done more for sand people than anything else. I mean, how about the fact, if just stick with the sand people for a minute, you go into episode 2 when Anakin attacks the camp.
Yeah.
And their living structures are totally different than the ones we've seen this camp have. I
but
love
they're
that.
Also similar.
Right. Yes. Yeah. Yes.
It's like a right. And I said right away, like, okay, they're taking him prisoner. And my brain goes, like, why? But then it's like, well, that's the thing we already have seen happen. We know that's what they do.
Right.
Because they took Shmi Skywalker.
Exactly.
So they take him. They look cool and they're different.
And he's basically tied up to it. Okay. So let's get to some weird things. The first thing is he's tied up to a stump. He wakes up tied to a stump. And there's a sand person, Tusken Raider kid.
Yeah.
And then all his friends come over and just beat the snot out of Boba Fett. Your kids do. Which is...
Yeah.
What was that about?
You don't remember doing that when you were a kid?
I don't remember, like, my dad telling me, go beat that guy who's tied up to that pole.
Me and my friends, we would wait until we found a homeless person that looked particularly tired and hungry, and then we just start hitting him with a wiffle ball bat.
Gosh. He's kidding.
Really tired us out. Yes. Also, one of the kids had pants on, which I didn't like.
That bothered you a lot.
I mean...
Yeah.
Pants.
I know. We're going to get into a lot of stuff.
It bothered me, too, that black's not a great color for Tatooine, but...
Yes! Two suns! Why not?
Why not? Yeah. So anyways, pants...
Beats them up. Then he wakes up again, tied to the same stump.
We saw Boba Fett wake up from various things a lot in this episode. You count every time he wakes up? It's like 12 different times. He's waking up from getting from the Sarlacc pit. He's waking up from getting beaten by kids.
He's waking up from Fennec Shand, waking him up out of the the pod. So he wakes up again.
Boba Fett awakens. That should have been the name of the
It was like an episode of Tom and Jerry. He's twisting the knots on his hands, and the massive, you know, the sand person dog thing, they call it a massive.
Right.
It's just, or a mastiff, something like that.
I think it's without a T, massive.
Massive makes more sense. Mastiff is an actual name of a dog, so they wouldn't go that deep, right? And so
maybe.
Every time he made a little wiggle, the dog would open its eye or something like that. So it was like cat and mouse. And then finally, the dog attacks him and he grabs it, and I thought he strangled it and then smashed it. But
so that's the thing, is like, that happens, and I'm like, oh yeah, here we are. Yeah. Robert Rodriguez, he's going to strangle this massive with his bare hands. And he just knocks it unconscious.
He's like, whoa. Dog's got to live. We don't kill animals at Disney.
Dude, and if you had successfully just broke it, and you could, okay, you want to give me a Star Wars reason? Oh no, their necks are so strong, they're impossible to break. Okay, fine, whatever. But let's assume that he could have broken his neck. You should have. He'd be free.
Yes.
I did like trying to use the rope, use the teeth to open
him up.
That's cool.
He asked the, oh God, what's that race?
Sand people?
No.
Oh, Rodian.
He asked the Rodian, you want me to cut your bonds? And the Rodian is just like staring at him. He's like, all right, fine. And then the Rodian starts squealing him out. So you know that dude's been broken already? That he's squealing out Boba Fett for escaping.
Like, I couldn't figure out if he could understand the Rodian or not, because the Rodian spoke, but they didn't use subtitles like they did for Greedo. Now, here's another thing. It's like, there are people like Joe, who I hope is listening, but I know he's not. There are people like Joe who love Boba Fett and have loved Boba Fett and have perpetuated this thing that he is just like the toughest guy in the galaxy. And there's people like me who have been like, no, he doesn't do anything in Star Wars if you watch those movies. So prove to me that he's tough. Anyways, watching Boba Fett tied up and beaten by children did nothing to make Boba Fett seem tougher.
There's a lot of that.
His many thwarted escape attempts also did nothing to help.
No, the escaping and then having a showdown with one of the sand people with the staff, right? Because this is what we're getting up to.
And to be fair, everybody, I gave him credit because I think a well-rested Boba Fett could kill a sand person.
Yes.
Even if he was unarmed.
Right. Even with a little stick.
I think so too. He hasn't been fed. He hasn't drank water. He's been in this. He's beat. He can't defend himself.
Exactly. So we're at that part after he tries to escape and they hunt him down with the dog that wakes up. Yeah. They have a little battle with a stick and the sand person has a big gaffy stick and beats the crap out of him. Then Fennec Shand wakes him up.
Yeah.
And says they're lining up to pay tribute to you. You got to get downstairs. So and then we get that 80s montage.
He was like having those dreams again.
Yes.
And she should have been like, no, those are memories. So like you weren't asleep. You're just remembering things. There's nothing else to do. You're just
all right.
Deprivation.
Yes, right. It's true.
But yeah, so he holds court.
Yes, but first you get the 80s montage of him putting on his costume.
I did like that. Although at first I thought it was Fennec Shand. I was like, oh, look at those legs. And I was like, oh, it's Boba Fett, Boba Fett.
So he gets downstairs.
Boba Fett.
He's holding court.
Yeah.
And this is the beautiful, this is my favorite parts of Star Wars, the reuse of masks and costumes. We get an Aqualish, which is like Walrus Man, right? We saw that in season 2 of The Mandalorian.
Yeah.
They used one of them right there to pay tribute. And then we got Transocean, which was funny because he's like, Boba Fett's weird. I used to work for him. What do you think that was? I think that was Wookiee fur that he was handing over. You saw that whole thing?
Oh, I didn't really pay attention.
I think it was a Wookiee scalp. Yeah. Because they're Wookiee hunters, the Trandoshans.
That seems like a bad profession.
Yes. So
and then he meets up with the mayor's underling.
Yes.
Who's a Twi'lek who's come to ask
for money.
For money.
Not give tribute. Give money. Yes, everybody else is giving tribute.
Let's talk about the scene real quick because there's a lot of things that I have to talk about. Firstly, I've talked about this before. Trandoshan speaking English, I didn't love. I know you said there's a precedent for it. I'm sure there is, but there isn't one on the screen.
Well, it's because Bosk doesn't even talk in the movie, right? He just
doesn't talk.
He does, right? When he's wiggling his toes, and he says, "We don't need their scum," and then he looks at him, blah, blah, he just says something like that. And that's it. Yeah,
I think. The reason you see aliens and subtitles and different like that's just a big part of Star Wars. And to me, okay, you didn't do it. You have to do it with the Aqualesh, which I'm thankful for.
Right.
Transocean, I didn't really love that. But then the
Twilight. Did we get subtitles with the Oculus?
Yeah. No, he didn't speak English. Yeah.
No, he didn't. But did we get?
I don't remember.
No. Maybe. We had.
Which I'm fine with as well. If he's got nothing important to say, then I don't need to read it.
We had the closed caption on for the whole thing.
Yeah.
I don't think we got anything for the Oculus because he makes a remark. He goes, "Did you get any of that?"
Like he's talking to the audience, like he winks at us.
Well, no, he's talking to Fennec Shand about it. But Disney's not a high on giving us closed captioning with aliens.
And I think that's deliberate. And I don't love that.
Okay.
Yeah. Nobody. There's no one who's more against child literacy than Walt Disney Company, by the way, everybody. No, I'm joking. I'm sure they're all for it. Anyways.
Jeez.
So yeah, I don't love that. And then we get the Twi'lek, which, like, again, like, you know, there's certainly a lot of precedence for Twi'lek speaking English. I mean, he does Return of the Jedi.
Oh, yeah.
But it was such a regular, like you've set this thing that Twi'leks have, for whatever reason, like a French accent. Then continue with that.
Yes.
None of the Twi'leks we saw had an accent. And I know neither did Bib Fortuna, but he had something when he spoke English.
He had a lot going on.
He had the sharp teeth.
Yes. You're right about – now, the French stuff comes, again, from Clone Wars.
Right.
You're right about that because I believe the Transdotians that we saw in Season 1 of Mandalorian spoke with British accents, not French.
Speaking at all.
Yeah. The whole heist episode, Episode 5,
yeah,
when they got to go break the guy out of the prison. First time you meet Bill Burr.
Yeah.
Yeah. They had a lot of speaking roles. The sister and the brother.
Those are Twi'leks.
Twi'lek. Yeah.
You said Transocean.
I'm sorry. Back to Twi'leks again. I'm sorry. The ones who speak French. Jeez. They spoke British.
Yeah.
They spoke English. So.
There was something.
They pulled away from the French right there and then, too.
Now, what you did do is I wanted to see that character get killed. I wanted to see him get dropped into
the mayor's buddy.
Yeah. Rancor or no. Just be like, all right. Like, they did. If that was their goal to get me to, like, dislike this character. Success.
Great job.
I thought it was like a little bit soft for you. Should have done something with his voice.
I feel like if this is the way Boba Fett's going to go for the next 6 episodes, it's 7 episodes long, I'm going to be a little disappointed. I need to see him knocking some people down, killing some people here. It's Boba Fett.
This is going to be a much longer episode than I thought it was going to be because there's just so much to ask about. So, and I'm going to do my best to keep it
in the length we're at, because right now he's just woken up. He's sitting on the throne. Yeah. People are giving him money or asking for money.
Well, here's the thing. Like, my biggest issue with the episode overall, and it's not huge, and you have room to fix it. As I'm watching this, I'm just thinking, I have no idea what any of these people want. I have no idea what Boba Fett wants. I have no idea what Fennec Shand wants. I have no idea what the Sand People even want with Boba Fett.
Right.
I have no idea what those people...
The Assassins were.
I know they want Boba Fett, but, like, honest to God, did they want to take him alive? Because it felt like they did. Or else, why wouldn't you have shot him? Like,
why wouldn't you use weapons that would kill?
Sometimes it's good, you know, to have questions for the audience to wonder about, but there's also, like, no, I need to, like... And I've talked about this before. I need to understand what gets Boba Fett out of bed in the morning.
Right.
And you could, and people out there could be like, well, you know, it's the first episode, whatever. No, I need to understand at least a little bit of it right now. Like, I knew Luke's motivation. Like, right away. I know he hates Tatooine. He's tired of it. He's got big dreams of the stars and all these sort of things. He's ready to go. And then there's also the connection to, you know, losing his family to the Empire and following, you know, his father's footsteps. Like, there's a lot there already knowing what he wants, you know. And even Han, who's like... You know what he wants. He wants to get paid. And you could say, like, that's the same for Boba, but, like...
Boba Fett wants respect. That's the only thing I can think of right now, from what I've seen, is Boba Fett is craving respect.
I don't know, though, because he keeps saying, I tend to, like, rule with respect.
And not fear, and I don't... We'll get to it. So the next people that show up are Gamorrean guards.
But also, like...
Let's talk about that for a minute, because it's going to bring into that whole thing about what Boba Fett is. These two Gamorrean guards worked for Jabba, and then when Bib Fortuna took over, they worked for Bib Fortuna, and they did not go down without a fight. Even when Bib Fortuna was killed, they wouldn't surrender. So the torture droid is like, you got to torture these guys.
Which clearly, for torture, he chose to torture their nipples, because for some reason they had their shirts off.
You're really big on the not having shirts,
It's just weird, like...
Well, they had no shirts in The Mandalorian either.
Yeah, but they were fighting.
Okay.
And on a different planet. No, hear me out.
Yeah.
Like, I just don't understand. Like, if you're going to give them, like, new clothes because they're prisoners, okay. Or if you're going to strip them completely.
They took their armor off. That's what they did. If you look at a Gamorrean guard, they had the hairy brown diaper thing. It's still on. They still had that. Okay? They didn't have their helmets on. They had leather hats at the time of when they were presenting themselves. They didn't have the shoulder pads or anything like that. They didn't have any armor. So that armor piece was taken off of them.
Yeah, it's not that much armor. I don't know. Listen, just strip them naked. And then when they walk in, there's a big black bar vertically that hangs down to their knees.
You have a thing for this because we didn't know if we were going to record the Christmas in the Stars episode.
Right.
We had our first ever test episode of reviewing Rogue One. And you talk about Darth Vader's junk in there. What is with you, man?
If anybody ever went back and listened and just counted the amount of times I talk about various characters'
junk,
I wouldn't want to know how many times that is because it's probably once an episode. But I digress. So
he stands up and says, "I'm not torturing him. I will not torture."
Yeah.
And he says, "Listen, you guys were loyal to your old masters. If I spare your lives, will you be loyal?" He didn't get the words "loyal" out before they both bent the knee, right?
And yeah.
So now he's got these two guys. I mean, right. Jabba had a ton. He's got two guys now. And they're making their way to what we assume is Mos Espa. This is a big question I have.
So it didn't look like Mos Espa from my recollection of it in Phantom Menace. When I read the Wikipedia article, it did say that that was Mos Espa.
Okay. Because
it's like a crater city. Like, it's got these cliff walls all around it.
Right.
And it extends beyond that as well. I mean, cities can be big. Look how big New York City is.
So I think we saw the outskirts of Mos Espa. I think that's what they're going to make it now.
I mean, mostly what we saw was, you know, where the slaves lived and where the pod racing happened. And you can see that stuff taking place.
Outside of the city.
Outside of the major.
So to be fair about this, I just want to give you this information. When the trailer came on that showed that city, Paul Bateman, who you know who Paul Bateman is, he's done art for Star Wars and Star Wars Insider Magazine and was a good friend to Ralph McQuarrie, so he knows a lot about Ralph's stuff. The first thing he did, within a minute of this thing going on, is he found the art from Doug Chang from Phantom Menace that this was the concept art for Mos Espa. And by God, that's what they just did. They took that art and turned it into Mos Espa. And it's fine. You don't have to see everything.
No, it's cool. Right? I think it makes sense.
Yeah, it's cool.
Yeah.
So while they're in Mos Espa, they stop at a... Where do they stop? What is that? A bar, restaurant kind of thing?
I don't know. It's some crime lord's place.
Right.
Where they... I don't know.
And who's still alive? Because he wasn't on the barge. But Max Rebo.
Max Rebo, yeah.
With an upgraded piano. It's pretty cool.
Yeah. Yes. And then, I mean, we don't know who the,
Yes.
Oh my God.
Biff.
That,
like, look at me pulling that one out.
I was like, I know so much about that band. I can't remember their species. we don't know about that. And we see the droid from, Star Tours. Probably not the exact same droid, but that droid type, which I thought was kind of cool.
Right.
And we see two pretty shirtless Twi'leks walk up.
Are we sure Max Rebo wasn't on the barge?
I'm not sure of anything.
I'm thinking now he might have been on the barge.
Yeah, but he might have gotten off before it blew up.
How did that guy get anywhere?
I don't know.
He's playing with his feet. You knew that, right?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I don't know. He can't walk? God. Doesn't make sense.
I think he's on the sail barge. I tell you right now, if you go into the sail barge right now or at my house, I did as accurate as possible. I think if you open it up, I think Max Rebo's inside of there.
All right. One, your sail barge isn't canon, okay? And two,
I just said I did as accurate as possible. So that means I went through video and saw that he was in there. Second, if he was in there and he did escape, how many people escaped this thing before it blew up?
The finale is Jabba comes back. I mean, Disney loves doing that. So here's the thing, is that we're at least half an hour already.
Yeah.
We can't sit here and talk about Max Rebo any longer. We have to move on, okay? So anyways.
What, are you catching a plane? It's, if we want to talk about Max Rebo, it's fine.
Listen, if you want to do a 2-hour Mandalorian episode, I'll do it.
Or Boba Fett.
Yeah. So So in the spirit of what I just said, I'm going to just skip right over why we felt the need to have Twi'lek shirtless as well.
That bothered you so much that so many people have no shirts on in this.
It's just like I've seen a lot of nipples in this show that I didn't expect to see. How many nipples do you see in A New Hope?
I'm going to say none.
Probably none.
Right.
The only nipples I know that I've seen is the Twi'leks in Return of the Jedi, because you can totally see them through her thing. If anybody out there doesn't know that, go look at that movie. Make sure you get a VHS copy. I don't know if they've ever tried to
erase
those, but you see those. And secondly,
Kylo Ren's nipples.
No, I don't count that as Star Wars. Oh. Secondly, the Rancor Keeper.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Nipples. Anyways, so they're there and they're like, hey, you.
Beautiful place though, huh? Not like a rundown joint. It was pristine. And it was clean, and it looked brand new. It looked like Canto Bight inside that place.
It looked like either a pretty expensive brothel or a pretty cheap restaurant.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But they asked, hey, can we take your helmets and have them
cleaned and serviced?
And in fact, Shannon's like, what are you out of your mind? Bob was like, here. It's like, that's how you know he's not a Mandalorian. Because, like, not only does he not care if it's off, he's like, yeah, whatever. I mean,
that's a great question. Do you think his armor has to be Beskar then, right? To survive the Sarlacc pit? But he wasn't even in the Sarlacc pit that long. Exactly.
I mean,
he talks about the armor in the second season with the Mandalorian saying that it was Jango's and it was given to him by his forebearers and all that. So I guess it is.
I feel like his armor, even if it looks rough, is probably pretty good.
Okay.
Just because, like, everything about Jango seemed like he had it. Like, it seemed like the cloners probably paid pretty well.
Right.
So anyways, it is just a little bit weird.
So we see Jennifer Beal?
Him parting with the helmet?
Yes, was weird.
Is kind of like a metaphor for the entire show. Like, we too are going to part with this helmet.
Right. Jennifer Beal's from, was it Splashdance? Whatever. It's from the 80s movie, if you didn't know. But she was that lead Twi'lek that was talking to him.
Who?
I'm not going to get into it with you.
From Seventh Heaven?
No. No. So,
sure, I'm not right.
Whatever. I'll look at it later. But she had a little bit of dialogue. She's like, you enjoy this place because it's now yours because he runs everything, right?
You're talking about when the next Twi'lek comes in.
Yes.
So that's
yes.
another issue I have. One, again, no accents. Two, she doesn't even like, just for the sake, like I get it.
Hi, this is who I am and I run this establishment.
And I understand that might not necessarily be how people come into a situation in real life, but just give us this one of like,
we don't even know her name.
Establish that this isn't just another underling, that this is the person you wanted to see. I feel like that wasn't clear enough.
Yes.
And also, why are we having this meeting, like, in the middle? Like, don't you have an office or something?
She wanted to. That was Boba.
Oh, okay.
She wanted to go somewhere else. He said, no, we could do it here.
He's like, I want
you. What she said, do you want us to feed and hose down your Gamorrean guards?
And I was like, please. Please. I need to see this. I'd be like, no, man. But I wouldn't mind going for a hose down myself. Like, okay, I guess the offer stands for you too.
So she's very gracious to him, and
she hands him a helmet full of money.
Filled a coin. And
he's like, great, thanks. I don't have any pockets, so I guess this is going to explain to the audience why
I'm holding my helmet on later on. And, they leave, and they walking in the thing, and I want to say this before we keep going. I wonder if they're trying to establish tension already between Boba Fett and Fennec Shand. Because everything that she tells him, he's like, no, I'm not doing that.
I don't know. I didn't really pick up on that necessarily.
So the beginning was...
No, you're right.
We should kill the mayor's guy. He's like, no, it's the mayor's guy. So she's like, that's a no. She's like, that's a no. She doesn't do that.
See, you could be right.
You don't take in the Gamorrean guards. That's a mistake. He takes in the Gamorrean guards, right? You should come in on a litter... Which is the first time I'm hearing that word, for to be carried into the town. Because Jabba was always carried into the town. And he's like, no, I'm not doing that. And then the first thing that the lady who owns the club says to him, he goes, I didn't know it was you because you didn't come in on the litter.
There's lots of them right there. Fennec Shand and Boba Fett, like, we only have a rough idea of why they're partners, why they're together in the first place. And I think that relationship is going to get built on
throughout
the episode. But that being said... I thought it was more of like a way to tell the audience of like, this is why Boba Fett's different than Jabba the Hutt. Like,
yeah.
And that being said, like, not for nothing, Jabba the Hutt, things were working out just fine. Like, what are the odds that you kidnap and imprison a Jedi's best friend. Like, the odds of that happening are so slim. And right, that's the only place Jabba the Hutt went wrong.
Right.
Was like, I pissed off a Jedi. Like, there's one in the galaxy and I pissed him off. So, maybe everything that Boba Fett was, maybe you should
just stick with it.
Jabba a little bit.
It was interesting. I wonder that if they're trying to build the tension there, because he didn't listen to her at all. But now they're walking around Mos Espa again and they get attacked by Cirque du Soleil.
Right, like we talked about, they get attacked by this gang with these shields and things. And there's a lot of cool action. The thing that I do love about that scene is they're fighting, and you said, you're like, where are their guards? Which is a good question, because like, we turned them down on being hosed down.
And they were right behind them.
Yeah. So anyways, they fight just the two of them, and then the guards come in. And I thought that was a really great moment to sort of like build up the guards. Because you don't see them do much in Jedi.
Well, guard killed one of them.
They
took a knife to the face. Yeah, they didn't show it.
I loved it.
Like, right, exactly. The guards they did more than he did.
They looked useful.
Here's a couple things with this fight. Do you remember the two seasons of The Mandalorian? You're complaining about this amazing rifle that he has that just turns people into clouds, and then he's never using it because it's too powerful. Well, he has Boba Fett's suit on, the knee rockets, the flamethrower, the rocket on there. He used the flame a little bit. They blocked it with the shield. That's fine. He had a rocket pack. Well, he also had a jet pack. He could get above them and then shoot them down. None of this.
He has a rifle,
but we're going to go hand-to-hand combat.
But that's the part that I didn't understand was like, well, he says like take him alive.
No, that's at the end.
But that's at the end.
There's a ring of guys there. You don't need to take all of them alive. You need one to have a mouth to tell you something. And Fennec Shand proved that because she kills one of them, right? Okay. That's where it gets weird to have that kind of fight. And the fight was underwhelming at best, right?
There were some parts that I liked.
The Gamorrean guard stuff was really cool. Yeah. Like that to the face was really cool. Okay. Here's the other thing. And forgive me with this, but I know he's taking a ton of whatever that electricity is. We're calling it a stun gun, a taser, whatever it is, right? But after they get most of the group knocked out or killed or anything like that, three of them run up the building to escape.
Right.
And then he remembers that he has a little tiny rocket on his wrist. So he shoots that, blows the guy up.
Yeah.
Fennec Shand pursues the other two. He yells at her, alive. He needs one alive at least, right?
Right.
Okay. Then he tells the pigs, bring me back to my back to pod.
Right.
Was that the electricity? Because I saw him fight a ton of stormtroopers as a sand person without his armor. And he didn't need to go back to a back to tank. You know what I'm saying? So why is he weak now? It has to be the electricity is what I'm assuming. Because they stunned him so many times.
Maybe he's just addicted to the back to tank. He's like, God, I can't stand reality. Get me back to the back to tank. Like he's, I don't know.
So I pressed up against that, but I mean that kept me explained, I guess. I don't know. What do you think?
Well, she captured one of them, but what did he tell her? Did we get that?
No. That's going to start the next one because
I was like,
as we've heard, the trailers have been nothing but the first two episodes. That's what we've heard the whole time, right? And let's face it, 60% of the trailers was in this first episode. The next episode, in the trailer, we see the door opening up to Jabba's palace.
Yeah.
She has that guy.
Yeah, and also, like, I'd forgotten, but he's left, gone to the back to tank.
Right.
And then once he gets the back to tank, we go to a flashback.
We go back to the flashback, which we got to cover now.
Which, the flashbacks really aren't bad. It might sound a little bit confusing the way we're talking about it.
They're not confusing at all
in the show.
They're
not confusing at all in the show.
So, he's again tied up to a post, the same post, and they do that little filter thing to make it like staticky, and then it
like
fades.
Like the Wayne's World, like,
should have done. And the kid again, the pants wearing kid, gets Boba and the Rodian, right, and brings his dog, and they go for a walk. Now they go to a homestead, not the homestead, a homestead,
right?
And they're getting robbed by maybe some Nicktoons. I'm not sure who they were, but they were on speeder bikes or swoop bikes, depending. They look like speeder bikes, like you said. And they, like you said in the show, they're really into the Justice League because they were writing, look like JL basically on the house.
Yeah, they did look like the Justice League logo.
Don't know why we saw this. No explanation to why we saw this at all. They come back
they're
down
like
the hill.
The sand person, the kid takes them. The kid's like, listen, I come over here and watch this guy get beat up every week.
How cool is this?
They come back every week and beat this guy up, and I just watch.
You're so dark when it comes to
No, like, I think, I assumed it was like, oh, I see smoke, let's go investigate.
Right,
I think
right.
They went to dig for
Dig for those coconuts. Little rotted pumpkins that they used in the Mandalorian season 2 because it has the water in them, right? So they're digging all those up. You don't remember that at all, do you?
No.
For episode 1. Cobb Vanth, I'm not drinking that. That stinks. He goes, you're insulting them. They're not going to help.
Oh, yeah. That's yeah, right. Yeah. That's right.
So he's digging all that up, and the kid's messing with him because he's pouring the water out over the dog so that he can't drink it. And then the Rodian starts sweeping the sand away, and you see a dinosaur hand is what it looked like.
Yeah.
And then
a monster emerges from the sand.
Yes.
Not a Krayt dragon. Does this creature have a name?
Not that I'm aware of yet.
We felt, and everybody at home can make up their own, we thought it didn't look quite Star Wars-y enough.
No.
I appreciated that it wasn't a Krayt dragon, because we got our Krayt dragon, Phil.
Yes.
But yeah, it was a little bit weird. I had said it looked like if J.J. Abrams had decided to do the Gorn monster in his movie.
From Star Trek. From the 60s, yeah.
And then you said,
well, here's the age difference between us. I pull up the 1980 Clash of the Titans and the Kraken with a sleaze stack from the, was it Lost War? Was it
you're
Lost
right.
War?
Yeah, Lost Land for Lost.
Land of the Lost. So that's my head right away. And we found a toy Kraken.
Oh my God, it looks just
like And
the same,
it looks
right?
just like
this the toy Kraken thing. Would have worked with like the 70s versions of Boba Fett figures.
Oh my God, I'm posting this on Instagram so everybody can see this. Yeah. I'm going to because it does.
Like, it was neat that he had legs in the middle that were arms sometimes and legs sometimes.
Which was cool. But it just
was ferocious.
I don't know why it didn't feel too Star Wars-y to me. I don't know if it was the head or
so
because.
Here's the thing.
Yeah. And good CG, too, by the way. It wasn't bad CG, it was just good CG. You know what I mean? I thought all the muscles worked perfectly and it did what it was supposed to do. It just didn't have that Star Wars look to it.
But, and beyond that, just to make it clear that we're not like, we know that when you see something new for the first time, you got to let it sort of sit in. But there's examples of things that we saw new the first time that we thought looked really cool. Like the medical droids that I think we both agreed
yes.
looked pretty cool.
Krayt dragon. You don't need to go that far back. The Krayt dragon.
Krayt dragon, yeah. So, anyways.
I'll give you one that we didn't like and then I think we got softer on it. Was the blue guy. Episode 1 of Mandalorian Season 1.
Oh, the, yeah.
Horatio Sands, right? And then we get him later on in the second season, you're okay with him.
I think that has a lot to like, him being pretty funny.
Yes,
And likable to see on screen right, in the right. second season. Yeah. Here's my thing. It's like, the whole time, I'm just like, you're Boba Fett. You got a little bit of whatever weird coconut water in you. Kill this kid. Kill his dog. Get out of here. Kill the Rodian if you have to. Or, like, Rodian seems like he would just do whatever you said at that point.
Yeah, at that point, yeah.
And I'm like, okay, like, he doesn't want to attack the kid because the dog is going to – I keep calling it a dog. The Massive is going to attack. That part I got, right? And then even, like, the kid goes to sleep. And we're assuming it's a child. It could just be a really short right. adult. Kid goes to sleep with the dog. And I was like, ooh, that's stupid. But I was like, no, like, the dog would wake up if Boba Fett tried anything. Like, I'm with you on all this. The idea that, like, Boba Fett was, like, too tired to, like, kill that dog, but could take on the big, you know, four-legged...
Creature
thing?
Six-legged thing, yeah.
But anyway, he does, and he wins the respect of the child, who takes him back to the Sand People to be like, hey.
I have a question about that.
Yeah.
I think the kid was passing off that he did it. Because he's running around with the head. Which is freaky as it is, going to everybody like, look what I did. And then his old man walks over and passes the Budweiser to the guy because he knows he's the one who did it. That's what I got out of that scene.
I don't think that's the case. Because I thought Boba Fett maybe wasn't tied up at that point. I could be mistaken.
I don't know, man.
But either way, no way would he be like, oh yeah, you totally did that, kid. Like, unless you... No, I don't think so.
I don't know. That's you got to watch that again.
And then we're... We're done,
I guess,
right?
That was it.
The things I wanted to bring up...
Sure.
...was, well, first of all, I did have this sense watching it of, like, really enjoying it. So I was just like, I'm really enjoying having new Star Wars content. I know that might sound redundant.
Yes.
But it was like, this is nice. I like it. And I said, like, a lot of this stunt work, even though I've said that the overall action or maybe, like, the intensity of it, was underwhelming. The stunt work I thought was really great. Like a lot of cool stuff with the Fennec Shand doing the chase scene and a lot of cool stuff like that. The other thing is back to just sort of like where we are as far as like what he wants. He has this sense of like, listen, I killed Bib Fortuna, so everybody's going to treat me like I'm the new guy, like out of nowhere. Like he's like there are some scenes in when he was holding court of like, what, he wants me, like, pay me, you know, like, why should, I just thought it was like a little bit strange. Like,
yeah, no, I know what you're saying.
Like,
yeah,
it's kind of hard to explain, but like, I don't know. I just feel like if I like went and killed the mayor, nobody would be like, oh, well, you're the new mayor now. So like there'd be, I don't know. It would just, his assumption of like he says a line, and I know it was meant for like comedy, but he's like, he's supposed to pay me. I'm the crime lord.
Right, right.
It's like, that's a little too,
a little lost it on that one.
Too like
yeah,
wink at the audience.
I get it. I get it.
And it goes back to like, what does he even want?
I do see if you kill the guy in charge, you, and no one fights you, you assume the throne. I can understand.
You're on your way, but like,
but now you have to get everybody lined in who might be against you. So that goes back to, who were those guys? I'm assuming the mayor sent them. How do we know it wasn't the restaurant?
Let's back up a second too. Mos Espa has a mayor? What? Like, even if Mos Espa has like a political leader,
could it be called anything else but a mayor?
A mayor?
That was way too real world. We totally glazed over that.
I know governors are like of planets, but just do that.
Governor Tarkin. Something we
something that takes it a mayor? Like, they have elections?
Yeah, it was a little freaky. What? For me. Yeah.
That was dumb.
Again, governor has been in there, so you're used to it. So you could, you know, even if they said that, I could go with it. But mayor stuff, I'm like, what do we got? You know, what else you got after that? A post office general? That's
also, this show, it's operating a lot on the idea that, like, Boba Fett has zero reputation. Like, he's worked with Jabba. He made references to working for that Trandoshan, although yeah. I feel like that doesn't really count because, like, if I hired a plumber to do the job for me, like, he didn't work for, like, I wasn't his boss.
Right, right.
But anyways.
He took money from him.
Or maybe he really did. He's like, no, I used to wash dishes for that guy. He had a restaurant.
I don't know, man.
That's the thing. It's just like, I talk about it a lot. I talk about, I've said it before, Diet Star Wars, which is kind of what I call Disney Star Wars, which is Star Wars that's lost a little bit of its bite. And times change. But that being said, I thought the Book of Boba, more than anything, would be the least Diet Star Wars. You know, the my Boba Fett, he's not going to just kill for no reason. But, like, I feel like he had a pretty good reason to just go ahead and murder that mayor's, like, friend or whatever.
Yes. Listen, yeah. I'm not there yet to say, I know what you're saying, but I'm not there that it's going to be pod committed for the whole series.
Oh, yeah, we can't judge the entire season.
Because I saw him kick ass.
Yeah.
I mean, he brought his name back. They did more for Boba Fett than anything else has done in season 2 of The Mandalorian.
I don't know, we got beaten with by a bunch of children with wiffle ball bats, but
I'm talking about this show. But I'm saying,
what I'm talking about
in The Mandalorian, though, he kicked ass.
No, he did.
So,
and that's why I was expecting more of that.
Right. I mean, so I guess we gotta wait and see. But man, hey, look, we talked for almost an hour on the first episode. That was probably what, 33 minutes or whatever it was, because it says 39, but you know they got credits.
I don't even.
And I just want to show you right here that there is proof that Max Rebo was on the sail barge.
I mean, it could have been just a different blue keyboard player. Or maybe you got... See, I'm trying to remember, like, Tales from Jabba's Palace.
Yeah.
But not that it's even canon.
Listen, he's pinned up against the back window. Maybe he saw the writing on the wall and just jumped out the back window.
Because, like, my species, yeah, we don't catch fire.
Could you imagine
there's a... safely on the sand.
There's a show about Bib Fortuna and Max Rebo surviving the desert to get back to...
Yeah. Yeah, I mean...
Right.
Makes sense. That being said, too, like, actually, I take back what I said about needing to, like, transfer the palace to a humanoid. Because I guess Bib Fortuna would have been there for, like, a little bit at this point. Well, yeah. Actually,
at least 5 years. He's there 5 years.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, yeah.
It's hard.
All happens before the Mandalorian. I forget that that's where he gets the armor, is the Mandalorian.
Yep.
So after, but yeah.
And Cad Bane sets that up because he has to tell you that Cobb Vanth gets that armor after Return of the Jedi. Like, so right after he gets that armor. So, you know what? We made a mistake. That armor is not on the Sandcrawler for that long. Because after the Death Star 2 blows up, which is Return of the Jedi.
Right.
That's when his town, Cobb Vanth's town, gets attacked and he escapes. So it wasn't on that thing that long. We got to apologize for that.
Oh, you're see? Right.
We
you're
messed
right,
that up.
Right, you're right.
The timeline is tricky. You got to be on top of it.
That armor could have only been there for...
A week?
A week?
Yeah.
Maybe?
Yeah.
And yeah, and what I said still stands.
I mean, now it just shows you that 5 years for what I have to figure out, and I guess this was the show is going to show us, is that why did he stay with the Sand People for 5 years?
Yeah.
It sounds like he, you know, when we see him, he's got the robes, he's got the gaffy stick, he's got a bunch of stuff.
Well, I told you he fell in love with a sand person woman, and he knew that, you know, society would never accept their love, so he stayed with them until she died of old age.
It's they're going to have to explain why he stayed for 5 years.
You don't have to explain anything. This is Star Wars.
Well, where I understand that. Stuff,
but yeah, that's
okay. And that Bib Fortuna didn't sell the slave one, he just left it in his dock for 5 years.
I guess, yeah.
You know? Or are you going to even tell me that he didn't stay with the Sand People for 5 years? They let him go right after he beat the Kraken, and now he's wandering the desert for 5 years to look for his armor?
Yeah, I just
get that's, armor. I guess that's a possibility. I mean, I can't wait. We'll see the next one. So it looks like we're going to get flashbacks woven into each episode, possibly.
Well, certainly we have not been caught up.
Right.
And we don't need to be. Like, 5 years can be a long time. So, like, a lot could happen in 5 years. I'm kind of hoping that it doesn't, though. Another episode. But I don't want to, like, I don't want to be on the last episode of the season still wondering about how we got to The Mandalorian.
Okay.
To put it that way.
I hear you. I hear you. All right. You got anything else? You took notes. I'm proud of you.
Yeah, it's a little bit. Little
in
bit
the dark.
Work. A little bit of work. Just things to, like, refresh my memory. And even though I don't know if it works out or not. But, yeah, it's good episode, and I'm excited to see the next one.
Definitely. Yeah, me too. Next Wednesday.
Definitely. We'll be talking about it a lot on the show, probably. Yeah, I just want to end it there.
Yeah, so this is our last episode for 2021, and we want to tell you that we have some big things planned for 2022 besides covering all the shows and whatnot. We got some cool stuff cooking, and I think we can make the announcement what we want to do, right? We can do that, right? What? So it holds us to us?
Well, I don't even know what it is.
Well, you know what it is. I've been talking to you forever about it. The 25th anniversary of the special editions is in 2022, and we're going to have at least one show a month that connects to the special editions. So it'll be a lot of fun. We're calling it the special edition year, right? We'll just go with that.
I guess.
All right. Guys, listen, thanks for joining us. And you can check us out on Twitter and Instagram. And please leave us a review. It really helps us on the show. If you could leave an Apple review or wherever else you listen to this, that would help us out a great deal. And if you want to get some merch from us, you can go to TeePublic and just check out Boring Conversation anyway. And you can get shirts, stickers, and all that stuff. We want to thank you. We had a great year. And we'll see you next week when we take on Chapter 2. Thor, why don't you say goodbye?
Goodbye, everybody.
Goodbye, guys. We'll see you next week. Go make some droids.